Ashet Audio presents The War Lovers, Roosevelt, Lodge, Hearst, and the Rush to Empire, 1898. Written by Evan Thomas. Read by Richard Davidson.
To Stephen G. Smith, my friend and a great editor. Introduction. April 23rd, 1950, Beverly Hills, California. His hand shook with palsy, and his body was wasting away. A few days shy of his 87th birthday, William Randolph Hearst had little more than a year to live. He had given up San Simeon, his castle in the California hills, and moved with 24 servants to a three-story, Spanish-style house in Beverly Hills, set amid 8 acres of gardens and palm trees. Hearst still loved to buy things, and at night he pored over catalogs of art objects and antiques. In between, placing orders for Baroque statuary or 50 Arabian horses, he would send cables to his editors in the Hearst Empire, dictating what they should print. Hearst had never been the smooth, ruthless megalomaniac portrayed by Orson Welles in Citizen Kane. His charm was quirky, and he could be soft-hearted to his employees. His paper still had the power to stir people, though they were now seen as overly strident and obsessed with the communist threat. Lately, however, he had been stricken with feelings of remorse, even self-doubt, and he now ordered a cable sent to all Hearst editors. The chief instructs not, repeat not, to press the campaign against communism any further. He wishes the campaign held back for a while, particularly the editorials. He feels we have been pressing the fight too hard for too long and might be arousing war hysteria. Using newspapers to create war hysteria was a subject Hearst knew something about. July 1st, 1898, outside Santiago, Cuba. The 35-year-old newspaper editor and publisher liked to think that the war against Spain was his war, that he had created it. This was an exaggeration, though not entirely. For more than 2 years, William Randolph Hearst had campaigned for an American invasion to liberate the Cuban people from Spanish rule. Not much concerned with proof, his paper, the New York Journal, had blamed the sinking of the American battleship USS Maine on a Spanish plot. When war was declared, Hearst had devoted the full resources of the Journal to covering the American invasion of Cuba. He had dispatched more than a score of reporters, chartered a fleet of 12 ships, and transported a printing press, a hot air balloon, and the first motion picture camera ever to film a war. And too restless to sit back in New York, he had come to Cuba to see the battle firsthand, arriving in yachting clothes and accompanied by a pair of showgirls. Gangly and bug-eyed, Hearst was almost painfully shy and stiff in public. But he was ecstatic about his work, which he described as the journalism that acts. He gloried in headlines that were bigger, louder, lustier. Dressed in the evening clothes he'd worn to the theater, he would sweep into the Journal's newsroom after midnight, ordering up stories that would shock, entertain, and remind readers of the long reach of W.R. Hearst. On the day of the decisive battle, he went ashore before dawn. He put on a scarlet red tie, matching his scarlet hat band, tucked a pistol in his belt, then mounted a mule, and headed with his entourage for the front lines. Not far from Hearst, waiting impatiently on a Cuban hillside teeming with troops, Theodore Roosevelt prepared himself for what he would call his crowded hour. It was a day he would always regard as the finest of his life. Roosevelt was pure act, according to his friend Henry Adams. Roosevelt liked to boast that he was fit as a bull moose, though at age 39 his muscles were beginning to run to fat. He had abandoned a position as Assistant Secretary of the Navy to seek combat as a cavalry officer. When he had joined the Army in May, the odds were greater that he would die of tropical fever than become a war hero. At the time, his friends feared that he was delusional. His wife and eldest son had been seriously ill, but, as Roosevelt would later confess, he would have deserted his wife's deathbed to go into battle. He wanted to become a legend, and he made sure to keep newsmen nearby to tell the tale, including a reporter from Hearst's paper, even though he personally disdained Hearst. On this hot July morning, he took his blue polka-dot handkerchief and tied it to his felt cowboy hat so it could shield his neck from the sun. But with the effect that the bandana streamed out behind him. Like Hearst, Roosevelt was a dandy. As he rode forth on his horse, Little Texas, toward the Spanish-held ridgeline known as the San Juan Heights, the kerchief made Roosevelt a target. Yet he did not dwell on mortal danger. He wished to be seen leading the charge. In Washington, D.C., on that warm July day, Roosevelt's best friend and chief political advisor, Henry Cabot Lodge, waited anxiously for news of the battle. In a room in the southwest corner of the White House, President William McKinley and top officials of the Navy and War Departments studied maps, plotting troop movements, and waited for messages coming in by telegraph or a new contraption, the telephone. Senator Lodge of Massachusetts was a familiar figure at the White House. He was the president's closest national security and foreign policy advisor from Capitol Hill. More than anyone, he was responsible for America's sudden, if somewhat accidental, emergence as an expansionist power. Several times during the day, the senator rode by carriage from his mansion on Massachusetts Avenue to the White House War Room to check for any word from the front. Natty, thin, haughty, the 48-year-old Lodge could be a forbidding figure, a cold snob in the view of many of his colleagues. Among his intimates, only his friend Theodore regarded him as sensitive and warm, full of big boyish enthusiasm. Lodge had stage-managed Roosevelt's career, and the two men shared a love of what Roosevelt called Americanism, a faith in the national spirit, which both men took to be brave, adventurous, warlike. But Lodge had opposed Roosevelt's decision to join the Rough Riders, and on this morning, as Washington awaited word of the attack on the Spanish fortifications, Lodge was seized with a mixture of excitement and dread. He revealed no feelings behind his severe Brahmin mask, confiding his fears almost unbearable, only in letters to his mother and his friend Roosevelt. Down Pennsylvania Avenue from the White House, in his book-lined rooms on the fourth floor of the old Shoreham Hotel, Thomas Brackett Reed was quietly brooding. A vast man, nearly 300 pounds of smooth flesh, the 58-year-old Reed was known as the Tsar. His serene countenance was sometimes compared to Buddha's, though his wit could be vicious. When a congressman, quoting Henry Clay, announced that he would rather be right than be president, Reed replied, "Well, the gentleman will never be either." As Speaker of the House, he was regarded as the second most powerful man in the nation and an obvious candidate for the presidency. He joked about the talk of his securing the Republican nomination in 1896. "They could do worse," he said with his dry Maine drawl, "and probably will." When McKinley won the post, Reed had been severely disappointed. Reed's campaign advisors had been Theodore Roosevelt and Henry Cabot Lodge. The three men shared a contempt for machine politics and mushy reformers, called mugwumps or goo-goos. The trio was highly literate, bound by a love of poetry and history, and in their individual ways, romantic. They routinely delighted in each other in their extensive correspondence. But their friendship had fallen apart over the fundamental question of America's future. Lodge and Roosevelt believed that America had to expand and seize new territories.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.